the LCK so far is that Draven.
Well, at the moment, we're going through the bans extremely quickly. The Ryze will be the final ban after the Zoe and the Jace have been taken away on blue side, which is quite interesting.
Is your boy Gragas going to hit the ban list? These are our Gragas jungle players of repute. Because Kingzone, you feel like if it's not locked in, then you could already assume Cuz Pawn is Yasuo Gragas again, right? They've been playing Yasuo Gragas wherever they can get their hot little hands on it. They're going to have access to all those picks, as Vladimir going to be the final pick in this draft. That means Lissandra is conspicuously open. Remember that Kingzone in particular, first picking Lissandra, doesn't mean anything about Gragas Yasuo. They play Lissandra top lane, and KT would probably want to prize that duo away, unless Kingzone are looking to mix things up.
And this Galio is an interesting one, because Galio has been picked into the Lissandra oftentimes in the mid lane as well. And we saw Sun having a fantastic performance on the Galio against Griffin for the Afrika Freak. So that's going to be locked in, but we don't necessarily know where the Galio is going. As Jarv in the fourth is taken by Score, and now Yasuo Gragas.
If it's last week, maybe you want to show something different this week. Heard a very interesting interview. I was watching Euphoria, and there was an interview with Nuke Duck on that show, and they talked about how Korean teams have been practicing one strategy each week for their duo of games. Last week it was Gragas Yasuo, and they're looking to do something different this week.
Well, Ezreal Tahm Kench is certainly a very easy one here for Kingzone if they want to lock that one away. Deft's Ezreal is super famous, and Tucson's Tahm Kench is super famous as well.
Kind of sad, though. I want to see Deft on Vayne, as a lot of pro players consider Vayne the answer to Galio support, but it might not be Galio support, right? There's no guarantee. The Galio will be the support champion. You already mentioned that it could be a mid lane choice there. So if you're going to show bot lane now, this is the time to go Ezreal Tahm Kench, the old Gen G special that became an everyone special.
Yes.
As time went on, KT in the first round probably want to confirm their roles. And it seems like when a BDD on global duty, but no, they notice Draven's open
it.
And they're taking it anyway.
That's exactly what Gango does. He is basically a Draven one trick here in the LCK. And Kingzone didn't respect it, so they're not going to ban it away. Gango has had some good performances on the champion, and in the game that KT won last week, certainly was always about the Draven, as Gragas is going to hit the ban list immediately.
I really like this red side spot for Draven over the blue side Draven in, say, Cuz or Pawn's pick if we had roles reversed.
Yeah.
Reason why I say that is, if you think back to how Griffin answered the blue side Draven, they flexed the Galio to mid lane and went Braum at BDD's pick, and then you have a level 1 god champion, right? Now you look at the level 1s and say, wow, Jarvan can spot, you can take your taunt at level 1. Because it's Tahm Kench and not Braum on Kingzone's side, the ability to at level 1 shut down Draven's kind of ability to overextend, go for vertical jungling is a lot more minute. So there's much more scenarios here where Draven gets more of an honest 2v2, and if you give Draven a honest 2v2, he's one of the most dishonest ability
exactly.
to abuse a laning phase. So there's a chance that Gango actually gets Draven in a spot where he can breathe.
Well, Zac is going to be banned away here as well. An interesting one, but certainly a comfort pick for Cuz. He's been playing very well on the Zac in times gone by.
I want to shout out Rascal, who at the start of the season looked like the big reason that Kingzone would miss out on playoffs. He was struggling in reverse matchups, losing both sides of a matchup. He was 7-0 Urgot, but didn't have anything else. We're like, okay, well, Urgot's gone. What are you going to do? Since then, his last six games are on Yorick, Camille, Lucian, Lissandra, GP, Vlad. All of them victories. So he's actually played six unique champions in six victories and is showing he actually has a pull to be feared in the top lane. We know he plays Lissandra top. That is one of the champions I mentioned here. So Kingzone have shown nothing in their draft at all, apart from their bot lane here, which is a super flexible one. And Snowflower, with his Thresh not banned, goes to his most famous competitive pick.
Yep, it is going to be the Thresh. And Thresh Draven is a terrifying lane to deal with. You'd hope that it's Ezreal that's soaking all of these death sentences, as Cuz is going to go back to a champion that he's had a lot of success on. And she does fantastic things in the early game. 5-8 is not a great win record, but for Cuz, it has certainly been a power pick. As now,
we want our
prophecy.
Going? We want to see the Yasuo come out here just so we get the answering Zed potential.
I have a feeling it's top lane that's going to be locked in here by Tucson, as Kennen is going to be picked up. Theoretically, still a flex, but it's likely that the Kenny is heading towards the top side of the map. We'll see whether it's going to be the on-hit variety that we saw Cuvée do fantastic things with recently.
Really depends on the opponent here. They could go for a Lucian top lane to try to punish an AP Kennen decision. They might even look at a Yasuo of their own. This would be a flex to top lane of Galios. It seems unlikely, playing with a lot of options here. Hard to find multiple laners that dominate a Kennen. in the top lane. Vladimir, for example, which hasn't necessarily been working for a lot of players. It's a classic counter pick. It's banned, of course. And we'll just go the Aatrox for lane power. What you can say is, if you ever die in the early game, return turret diving cannon looks pretty reliable with Jarvan Galio to guest through that lane.
I really wish that this was actually happening.
I know. We're probably not going to see support cannon anymore. I asked Gorilla when he was going to bring it out. He was our most famous support cannon player. And LS just couldn't handle it if Thomas Kench was sent to the top side in a pro game and he wasn't casting. So we get the much more normal lane assignments. KT could look to snowball through cannon, but in a vacuum, Kennen going to have a pretty fun time just farming away against Aatrox.
Yeah, we'll see what style of Kennen this is going to be. The on-hit Kennen is absolutely a menace in the split push game if that's what Kingzone want to be doing, but they do have a lot of flexibility with this draft. Once you get to two items on that Ezreal, it will unlock this map, and you'd be okay with Kennen and Lissandra sitting in side lanes. Both of them do reasonably well. And Cuz is going to have a lot of agency in this early game. I feel like Kingzone's draft is very well-rounded. Here moving into game number one, looking on the side of KT, they do have a lot of options themselves, but it is all about Gango and whether this Draven can get off the ground. We know he's a Draven one-trick, he's fantastic at the champion, but this is much more linear.
Exactly. You look at the draft, you're like, that's four big boys and a Draven.
Yep.
The enemy team only really has Kennen to get the backline, unless it's mid-game, where you maybe get Lissandra to blow people up. So if we don't see a gold lead in the mid-game for Kingzone, who's to say Draven doesn't hold strong? A couple of cash-ins later, anything could happen.
Yep, could be a big deal here for KT. We'll see what happens as we get into game one. The main thing that we're going to be looking out for is not necessarily the sepia mode, but it's whether or not Deft is going to get five kills this game, because that will mean that he'll join the ranks of a lot of other players who have made it to the 1,000-kill margin. I think the last one that we saw might have been Prey?
No, Prey was the second one ever. So
all right.
I'll cast my mind back and try to get them all. Get my fingers out. Remember,
Ambition.
Faker was number one.
Yep.
He was the first one to do it. It was Prey after Faker. From there, the order is a bit fuzzy, but Score definitely has it. Ambition has it. That's four already. Kuro has it. That's five players who've reached the match. Bang. Is number six. So we're missing two players. Hit that 1,000-kill mark. Gonna have to cast my mind to all the players we've had hit 1,000 kills on the domestic scene in Korea. There are further ones from there. Don't have OGN making videos anymore, but a lot of people hyped about the 1,000 kills. Sangyun was the most recent one.
Ah, yes,
he followed
was.
Ambition, so that's seven. So we're missing one, Atlas. One person deserves their shout out here. Gotta remind.
Was it a top laner potentially?
Was Smep.
It could have been Smep.
Might have been Smep there.
Sort of where
yes,
I'm casting my
Smep.
Mind back to. But Deft 1,000 kills, you can see so many fans are focusing on this one. Chinese fans in the audience here today.
Deft is just popular around the world, right? So that's the Chinese fan club, as it said in English.
Of
the
course, Deft very famous there. In China.
How long is that alpaca? I think it's acceptable. It's not too long for Papa Smithy this time. But we're always on our lookout for alpaca. No one gets more adorable adornment.
Yes, oh,
I did just say adorable adornment. That's good old Deft.
Yeah. Very, very cute. I love the alpaca meme. It's one of my personal favorites.
And it'll never die.
Nope.
They say legends never die. That particular meme, never going to die either. We want this pause to die in a fire, but unfortunately, it will extend for now.
It is unfortunately on the KT side. There's a bit of computer lag, which we had briefly. Yesterday,
I'm pretty
Breeze
sure
carried the game. Rascal.
That's not what Deft looks like if he gets the 1,000 kills. I think he looks. It looks like he's been denied in this game.
Yeah, and Deft actually sometimes does look like that even when he's happy. He's not necessarily the most emotive.
I think
the players might be ready relatively soon.
Good to hear. One of the reasons we always have pretty full arenas here in the LCK is we have all these legendary players who were so relevant 5 years ago and are still around. Of course, some of them are on struggling teams. Some of them are on surprising teams, like Kingzone, who have really firmed themselves as top five. NA greater than KR. I mean, if you look at Worlds, he's pretty aware of that. He seems to be looking to confirm it. I'm not sure if this particular series
Well, this
will
is Korea
it.
Versus Korea, so you're not really going to get much information there. However, MSI is round the corner, so some opportunities for the potential LCS representative. But here we are. Sepia mode is over. No more pauses as Gango and Snowflower are getting corralled here. by the catfish and his friend.
Nice to see KT trying something at level one. Trying to get some information. It's going to be mostly run by Kingzone, even though I wouldn't say they have categorically a better level one. They got the Ezreal to look around and try to thrift shop away, steal away some items with the Kleptomancy.
Yep.
No stealing to happen yet.
Nope. KT have gone for the exhaust on the bottom side of the map, as you can see, Rascal, first time on the cannon, seventh unique champion in a row here for the Kingzone top laner.
Yeah, they want all one-offs, but just the fact they've won six games and he's played six different champions is something to commend a player who, again, we were laser-focused
about. He was the Urgot one-trick, right?
You were just ready to point at his 7-0 Urgot, not much elsewhere, is the reason they would struggle, but he's starting to come of age, and he's a player who always was interesting, because when he did play instead of Khan on Kingzone, he was always just a little bit more subtle than you might expect for a young player finding his feet at the pro level, but we couldn't have a complete information about him because you always think about who wasn't playing. That's why giving him an entire split, he's not a rookie strictly, but he's definitely been one of those players who had the honest kind of sports movie arc of coming in looking like a player who'd never started in the LCK, but then finding his footing and now his confidence to play all these unique things.
And now he's going for the Kleptomancy as well. So speaking of confidence, certainly going aggressively. Score is going to be completely spotted out here by this ward bottom side of the map. He tried to cheat a red start, but it was spotted out there by Deft.
And Deft is able to push up so aggressively and doesn't have to respect a level 2 ping on Draven Thresh. So already got the level 2 ping first. It seems like Tucson missed some experience as he was level 1 for a bit of it. But anything to get Deft the Arcane Shift before an all-in can come out.
Yeah.
From Draven and Thresh, his happy days, as Deft has no doubt faced plenty of Dravens in solo queue. Now he has to deal with them in competitive play. Probably not the happiest alpaca with that news.
No, but he is on his Ezreal, probably one of the more famous Ezreal players in the world. Certainly does play a lot more aggressively than, I guess, the other main Ezreal player, which is Teddy here in the LCK. His score's wrapping around for a very early gank. There's the flash in from BDD. Horn has to get the flash to get out. The claw is going to be enough, though. An aftershock keeps him alive. Score, successful gank to start this one off.
Bit too hasty from BDD and score. They could not overlap CC, even though with the Justice Punch used late, there was a chance there'd be no time to flash. Instead, Horn gets away. Pretty unscathed. Yes, a trade of summoners, but it could have been oh so worse.
Yes, and also I did like the idea from KT, because then they can get in on the Lissandra before the Ring of Frost can come out, and therefore the aftershock can be activated. So I didn't understand the thinking. However, it just didn't quite work out, as both Score and BDD had to flash in trade for just Spawn.
But that tells you how off the communication was, because they used two flashes and didn't get overlapping CC, so something to VOD review there, as Death says, Matt, press the attack Draven. This sucks.
Yeah, this is really starting to hurt.
And the press the attack is unique, right? We've seen Kleptomancy on Dravens around the world.
Yep.
Conqueror's kind of gone because you can't prep it on minions anymore. And it's, for Draven, a very big nerf to Conqueror Draven, so it's almost not even worth going.
Fleet Footwork is also another one that a lot of Dravens do decide to take.
I think even that's pretty trashy, to be honest. So
it's not great, but I think it is an idea.
For standing trades can definitely work. It's just we should always point it out, because it feels like no two Draven players think about the Draven rune choice the same.
I think Gangos is probably the most Draven option that you can take. Highest damage potential over extended trades. As our Rascal, having a great time. Here, just trying to proc that Kleptomancy over and over again.
Should
We've mentioned
it.
This a lot of times.
It's just a really free spot to take Kennen, right? You
knew
that the effective champion pool for most top laners isn't something that works into Kennen. We talked about the Kale that Kingdom's been playing in solo queue. You're not playing that into Kennen, so it's never going to happen. Mages especially ruin the day of good old Kale, who's enabled for the first time today if you're joining us late. Cuz is on the Rek'Sai. You look at the lanes that Rek'Sai has to gank and you say, man, feeling pretty good about the solo lanes. So.
Oh, yeah.
With the priority in mid lane for now, able to take down the bottom side Scuttle, and it should be complete run of the jungle and just a really obvious 1-2 item power spike to play around when this game opens up for Kingzone.
Oh, Pawn taking a lot of damage here from BDD. As you saw there, did go into Inspiration Tree second. So I believe that was Time Warp Tonic that did crop up there, and you can see with the Corrupting Potion on cooldown, that is exactly what he has taken. Minion Dematerializer going to be the second option.
For the longest time, BDD had amazing KDAs and
Whoa.
Win rates on that Galio, as Deft doesn't stop Arcane shifting in, even if it is a Draven Thresh lane. Kuz is tough.
Yep, and Rascal, he's hit level 6. There's no level 6 for King, and this gank timing is phenomenal, and that's just Rascal doing all the work. Cuz comes on over, gets an assist somehow with a Prey Seeker, I believe. But that was all canon.
But it was also so well communicated by the two youngsters, relatively, on the side of Kingzone, right? These are two players who we haven't necessarily had the highest expectations of, and the timing to be top as that level advantage happens meant there was never any chance they weren't going to pick up the kill. Beautifully executed by Kingzone. It's around Cuz and Rascal, not the two least standing members of the Kingzone starting roster.
Yeah, we're going to have a look at this one more time. This was Rascal just getting that level 6 exactly when he needed to. Entirely calculated, guys. It's just beautiful play from the cannon on the top side of the map.
Just talking in the key of the communication here between Cuz and Rascal. They knew what was going on. Feeling good about it. And you do wonder, the player who we've always complimented for his top laner sense has been Smeb out of the roster, King and in. And that gank looked a little bit too easy for the side of Kingzone.
Yep. And Gango, not going to take too much damage there from Deft, who still has his teleport in order to get back into this lane. But now that Gango has himself a BF sword, you have to imagine that Deft is pretty keen to go the heck back home.
And all Ezreal and Tom are trying to do in this lane is to go CS for CS and not die. There's no way to open up a CS advantage without a lot of jungle help or a level 1 that really puts Gango behind. They can't blow his summoner, so Gango unlikely to pick up a kill in the 2v2. There's so many not dying buttons between a Tahm Kench and an Ezreal. Very likely to stack up the passive, though, and it's going to be all about teamfight execution to get the value from there.
And you can see KT are very, very interested in getting Pawn behind here in this early game.
Believe the information advantage is on Kingzone's side with the control ward that was on the brush there. So everyone backs away. No harm, no foul.
Yep. There's a cute one from Pawn throwing out the claw aggressively to last hit. Almost a taunt, as you can see, Cuz is having his run of the jungle at the moment. 52 to 41, as the camps just keep falling down in favor of Rek'Sai. She farms so quickly. Doesn't even need to pick up the Tiamat like she used to when she was power farming.
Guys are at home, were wondering before the items came in, would it be AP or AD cannon today? If you see Kleptomancy, it is invariably going to be the AP cannon variety to get that first item power spike as early as possible. Cuvée played the on-hit cannon recently. It's press the attack is the one you're looking for there. So usually, not 100% of times, I believe it's been subverted once or twice in history. If you see Klepto, you can expect it to be the AP build. And AP build gives more threat onto Draven. Again, he has such a strong frontline. But you do think if Draven gets two items, a couple of cash-ins, there is always that chance that KT can make this happen in the late game, as right now.
Yep, Justice Punch comes in, Pawn has to ultimate, does have that blue buff running, but not a lot of mana. His score goes down and Deft picks up the kill with the True Shot Barrage. Cuz goes underground and picks up the second one. The bait was beautiful, and Kingzone 3-0.
Some masterful baiting and some great pathing again to be around mid lane for Cuz. It's suddenly 3-0. It's suddenly the frontline members that don't do a lot of damage falling behind, and only a Gango cash-in can find some light at the end of the tunnel, because right now the mid-game is looking so perilous for Kingzone.
It's ridiculous. Deft has got a red buff that he picked up from the mid lane whilst staying in his lane. Tucson goes down. I mean, there's a lot of damage there, but the Grey Health is going to be eaten. Didn't need to activate at all. As you can see, Deft going aggressive onto Gango. This could actually be a problem as Whirling Death does come down. This should be a trade as the exhaust comes in. Last auto is going to be enough there, but not worth it. It's the double kill and the big old cash-in for Gango.
The cash-in is the difference in gold. 500 gold cash-in explains why at 2-1, Draven goes back and gets a 9-minute Bloodthirster. That's the only thing that's gone off this game so far for Kingzone. KT desperately needed some inroads on the Draven.
Yep, and they kill that red buff immediately as well. So that goes down with Gango, unfortunately. Kingzone, it was close to being far worse. As if this Draven had any more attack speed, it would have been a dead Ezreal. This was the attempt on Pawn's life, but it was just great ultimate timing. And Cuz has a lot of follow-up damage.
Two times Pawn has been able to escape scenarios where if you overlap your CC perfectly, there is no Ring of Frost, there is no self-ult, and the kill goes through. But we see a mistake down bot lane. The ignite is early just to cycle out cleanse, and they want a Gango to disengage. But then Deft walks up, and this actually extends. And if this doesn't happen, this aggressive arcane shift that's been Deft's plan the entire laning phase, there's such a real chance that they're so behind in the mid game with no cash-ins that Draven, whether he's 0-0-0 or not, can't do the damage to justify the front line. The only way back in after we watch the other lanes is Draven getting gold. Maybe that is the slight invitation to KT need.
Yeah, Mirror Mana is now completed here for Death, though. He's still going to be very strong. Has himself remember the Kleptomancy, so he'll be able to get gold. At the moment, he is down by 10 CS, as you can certainly imagine, in this lane. Gengo with his Bloodthirster keeping him pretty much immovable from this lane, and now the Whirling Axes basically ending the minions' lives before they've even done anything.
Now if you take an aggressive Arcane Shift and you're not baiting for your jungle, it's a mistake. He has too much lifesteal and an overshield.
Yeah.
That you can't DPS through with any cute poke from the Ezreal, still getting his item build together. Speaking of getting things together, we do see Kingzone trying to pick up this Rift Herald on the top side. Very little Kingan can do, doesn't have lane control against Kennen, so this should be a freebie. And all Skor can do is in vision, try to take a Ocean Drake to answer.
Yeah, you can see so much vision, though, available for Kingzone bottom side of the map. They know that Gengo is certainly the avenue for victory here for KT Rolster. And that means that KT have to do this on complete vision of Kingzone. But BDD is going to have to watch his tower fall down because Shelly set up shop here, and KT are going to have that three-man rotation over from that bottom side. Vaughn gets all of those turret plates. Only one more remains, and two more minutes are there in order to do it. You can see that has already translated into close to a 3,000 gold lead here for Kingzone. Double Kleptomancy, of course, helping out.
Definitely seeing everyone other than bot lane doing super well. The side of Kingzone, Cuz playing around priority. Top side of the map is a safe place to go for now. See if BDD can find an aggressive use of his hero's entrance, but Corral feels like outside of the 2v2 kills that Gengar was able to pick up, Kingzone are kind of dripping the little things that KT are able to pick up. It hasn't been KT who's been able to influence this game outside of that 2v2 strong play, but a turret play comes in. And the weird thing is, you'd give up quite a lot around the solo lanes to get Gengar advantages if you're KT. So even with Kingzone doing their heavy lifting elsewhere, Gengar finding gold. If Gengar's 0-2 here, I don't know if there's enough kills in other lanes that could tip that particular scale given where this game goes. So KT, all things considered, they'll be content with the early game.
Yeah, they will. Thing is, it's going to get more difficult because Deft is going to build Ninja Tabi and the Iceborne Gauntlet, and then basically he's not going to be too worried about Gengar's damage in the mid-game. Gengo will, of course, be picking up his Infinity Edge as item number two. He's got a cheeky longsword there as well. And he's going to be doing a lot of damage, but Deft is going to be building more resistances and will scale more nicely as this game goes on.
You remember the Telecom War? We had Gengo on Draven. I want to say Drango every time for some reason. We had Gengo on Draven, and Mata made a hasty engage around the Raptors in a game they were way ahead of. Gengo got two cash-ins and was able to hard carry. And this is another one of those games where everything's set up for Kingzone to hit the mid-game running, but already Draven has some items. He gets IE and high rolls and some crits and frontliners. Doesn't really matter who you are. You shudder at how much damage Draven can do. You always need to really dot your I's and cross your T's against Draven, because his snowball is out of control. And speaking of out of control, that's just cheeky.
Yep, that's a Prey Seeker that steals away a blue buff. At that point, I'd be saying go next if I was KT. As soon as that happens, that's too much salt in the old wound. Oh my goodness. That is from going from good to better very, very quickly as Skor. He's on the bottom side of the map, but I don't know whether Kingzone are going to fall for this one. They've got a very defensive bottom lane. Snowflower looking for the hook, gets it onto Deft. We are going to have the double flay to come in as well, as Tucson has to flash. Eats the gray health as Gengo. Whirling Death is just going to straight up miss right off the edge of Runeterra. Does pick up Deft on the back end, but True Shot Barrage comes in. There's no Unbreakable because there's no Braum. And no more turret plates for Gengo to take either.
Creative timings for going for that nice little spectator move there. Sees the hook land. They do DPS Tucson out, and Deft is low health. Skor just sticking around. It may not be turret blades, but a turret is still a nice return. Kuz is here to try to pick up the slack.
Yeah, he should be able to get it as well, as that is a control ward that's working out here as Gengo. A couple of autos will be the end of Deft's life. He does have the frozen fist, And he's going to be heading back now. See whether Ninja Tabi can actually be completed on this back, as Pawn's already taken down the outer turret in the mid lane. The Lissandra is honestly smashing this matchup at this point in time. 4,000 gold, that lead is only continuing to rise, even if kills aren't necessarily coming in.
Scorn needs to find something fruitful. Desperate to get this bot lane turret to unlock Gengar. This should be the moment.
Yep, they are going to be able to take it down. Demolish proc there from Snowflower. Says thank you very much. Laning phase most likely over, and Gengar does have the advantage.
He's definitely in a great spot. It's hard to be much better. Yes, he died, but it was the perfect time to die. It was after he'd cashed in, so no gold.
Yeah.
Just kind of left wanting when it came to his death. Ezreal just start being
doing
a jerk.
His Ash impression.
Yeah.
That's a Hawkshot that hurts.
We had a triangle of Ezreal guards, and we're only left. We're deft when it comes to classic Ezreal guards, and like you mentioned, people like Teddy trying to join that list.
Yeah, Teddy's certainly a fantastic Ezreal player. He's proven himself time and time again, and it was last time SKT met Kingzone. Actually, no, it was the first time those two teams met, and it was Deft versus Teddy, and they were trading back the Ezreals, and the Ezreal just didn't seem to lose in that matchup.
You wonder if Prey could be convinced to come out of retirement for summer. Can't
especially with all these Ash
that.
Picks coming in
exactly.
As well.
And Ash, Ezreal meta, and Prey not around.
Yeah, we need to bring Varus back. You know, he needs as many users available as possible.
No more Varus.
Well, Pawn's going to come in, and they're looking to try and get rid of King in here. World Ender does go down, but Kingzone should be able to just wait this one out if they want to. Pawn gets the Aftershock, and now Kinnan has to try and flap his little wings as fast as he possibly can. The ultimate does wear off, and he creates enough distance as Deft and Tucson turn up towards the top side. Devour going to be used very early as an Ocean Drake is the second roll, and that means Kingzone straight up don't care. They'll take down another outer turret, top side of the map, and look to push further forward.
If I'm SMAB, I'm already kind of flexing, getting ready for game number two, because King once again had very poor synergy with his lanes as no steel comes through there. If we get a replay of how that actually happened, he instantly flashed away to safety and ulted, then re-engaged because BDD called that he could ult. So there was no synergy between BDD and Kingan on how he was approaching. And yes, it's always scary to be ganked, but you need to be in constant communication with your lanes. And the communication was actually pretty off there between KT's, you know, much more short-term top laner in Kingan and their long-term starter BDD.
Well, now you've got an outer turret still standing here in the mid lane with basically its entire health bar and an Ezreal there to defend it. So Def very comfortable. Gets his evolution at level 11. Pulse Fire Ezreal, my personal favorite skin, mostly because Def plays it. I like to think that it does more damage.
He's always had a lot of problems with auto attack animation, and there was the bug where you'd kill a minion
and
it wouldn't show gold.
Yeah, didn't actually work, yeah.
So I understand why most players don't take it, but I agree. Seeing it from time to time makes me happy.
Deft has been on it all the time, and those particular issues with the skin are now gone. So feel free to play Pulse Fire Ezreal. It is absolutely fine.
Rascal hanging back and leashing blue buff for now. Potential it's going to be stolen away. Lane assignments kind of suck here for KT because BDD has the global and is not in range of Hero's Entrance, would have to teleport. So you're pretty happy as Lissandra if you can drag Galio to the bot lane in a moment like this where he really wants to hit a teamfight assertively.
Yep.
So I'm going to put the blue buff onto someone we know who can use gold in the mid game. That's Death on Ezreal. Gengar pushes up in the mid lane. Just wonder where the next flare point in the game will be, because after the early action, we're kind of already on Baron o'clock 45 seconds before it spawns.
Yeah, exactly. So that one's going to be coming up very, very soon already. Remember, Shelly went down in the mid lane, so that advantage did go over to Kingzone. However, KT do have two of these Ocean Drakes. They can go for more of these skirmishes, get some of that health back, but not exactly the most valuable. And the third Drake on the map is going to be that Ocean Drake as well. So feels like Kingzone are high-rolling, purely because they haven't been putting any emphasis on picking up those dragons at all. It's meant that when they do go for these topside plays, there's no real advantages that KT can pick up for themselves.
It's nice that you can abate some of the siege damage by disengaging for a couple of seconds, not having to recall on double Ocean Drake.
Yeah.
Will be slightly useful in that area, but it feels like it's going to be about a mid-game teamfight. The gold lead will be on Kingzone at that moment, and if they win that mid-game teamfight, they have a champion lineup that can really close the game out. But if KT can find an even trade, can delay this, can keep the gold lead 5k or less, there's always the chance that in Draven we trust is the story. Right now they're posturing for a turret dive, but Tremor Sense does a lot in relieving pressure here for Rask.
Yeah, Cuz actually with a lot of utility available. Uh-oh. As Tucson and Depth going aggressive. Cuz gets a decent knock up into the back line, but he's most likely going to die. That slicing Maelstrom was huge as Snowflower goes down, but the Whirling Death is going to be utilized here as great devour there from Tucson, looking to spit pawn back out right into the middle of the team. The ultimate's gigantic as Depth takes down Gango, gets himself over the wall. He's going to be absolutely fine as Kingen had the world end up, but he's still going to die in King Zone. Just style on the team fight.
They were playing in fine margins. They wanted to be able to execute, but crucially, they get Gango down. You don't need to see the rest of the team fight from there. If Draven dies, so do KT. And they come out with 5 kills for only the singles. Actually, the 2 deaths on the side of Cuz and Rascal.
Yep, Cuz and Rascal go down, but Rascal got so much work done. That slicing Maelstrom was gigantic. Right into the back line, and then Depth gets himself to safety. Mystic shot after Mystic shot over the wall means that KT were routed.
But you do notice they never had a 2-part plan to get onto Gango. There's a lot of single members diving in, and after this moment, where he outlasts the level 2 Kennen ultimate, you wondered if Gango could do it, but they were still holding on to resources. Speedity's re-engaged onto one man when Tucson had Devour up, and this time it's Pawn as the third time's the charm. They get the close up, they kill Gango, and from there KT have no backup carry.
Yeah, that AoE into the back line was beautiful. You saw Depth able to stay over that wall, even though it was envisioned, no one could actually get to it.
They got the clear calls here. They knew it was all over. And let me show you a number. Deft is at 4 kills. The next person to go down from KT will be the 1,000th domestic kill in Korea in the LCK. For Kingzone Dragon X is Alpaca.
Yep. The former KT player, the carry from 2018, was so incredibly good domestically at the end of last year. He's continued to be fantastic here this year, but for a different team, Kingzone looking much better. Feels like they've almost picked up the KT mantle with how they play, which is just hilarious. I guess whichever team Pawn plays for, inconsistency follows.
It's our time to predict. I'm going to choose the narrative prediction on the victim of the 1,000th kill. I'd love to see Depth take down Score for old buddies having a little bit of a tussle. Who do you think is going to go down for the 1,000th kill? Seems almost guaranteed to happen in this game.
I think it's going to be Snowflower.
Okay.
Personally.
I mean, choosing the people that dive in and not the, not the Draven is probably
the people that
safe
dive
choice.
Fastest was what I was going for. Score does have a BF sword. He is building towards the Guardian Angel, so taking Tarzan's mindset, but not necessarily his aggressiveness, unfortunately, in this game. King is rotating over. Gango's getting all of his health back very, very quickly. As Ocean Drake goes down in favor of King Zone this time, they're trying to cycle it through, but they'll only get a Clown Drake. As their next one, shout out to LS. Don't worry, I'm keeping the right words as Kingen has to flash. World Ender's in there, but he's down immediately into the stasis. Inner turret's going to go down. The Preyseeker even lands there as Kingen has to take the lantern in order to get out. And KT, they're just trying to put out too many fires and they don't have enough firemen.
I agree with you. They also don't have vision of all the fires. There's so much of a vision lead, Tremor Sense and Ward lead on the side of King Zone. They've hit the mid game running. This is when I believe they are at their strongest. See, Deft already ready for the double tier removal. Hasn't even gone double tier. He wanted the power now, and I think this is the right call. It's always situational about whether you buy Lost Chapter and then build, say, a Vamp Scepter if you go for Blade the Rune King or a Gunblade. I prefer Blade the Rune King and running because, again, only way KT win is the frontline gets tanky enough and Draven gets enough items. You go Blade now, the frontline ain't that tanky, and it feels like Kingzone pre-30 are going to close this game out.
Yeah, Deft actually completed the Lost Chapter as you were talking about it as well, so it doesn't even have that next tier stacking at all. Building an Archangels does mean that once that item is complete, that stacks very quickly, especially on an Ezreal who can just throw out spells so often, so I like that choice.
But it's like an insurance double tier rather than a, at 30 minutes, I have all my power double tier, so I don't
And that's
mind.
Why Lost Chapter exactly. just plays into that even more, so I like it a lot.
Getting the immediate power. They don't want it to go late, but Def wants to be ready if it does. What are the camps that KT now own because even Krugs are being stolen away? They chase in here. Deft continues to arcane shift in the womb direction. Pawn pokes around, and unless KT get a couple of fast kills on Draven, feels like the next fight might be the game closer.
Yep, BDD actually just taking a lot of damage here as Pawn gets a cheeky Q off, and I don't think the Galio can actually engage. Kingen is looking to try and get in there, but immediately Score. Is he going to go down? Is it going to be 500 kills? here for Deft. He's in the back line as Kingan's trying to take him down. Worldender is going to keep the Aatrox alive as in goes Rascal. The slicing maelstrom is gigantic. Flashes forward. Gango's going to get stunned. The cannon grabs the first kill as Cuz grabs the second. And KT, they've got nothing left. Gango's trying to get a kill. He does almost pick one up. It's actually Kingan that steals that one away. And now Deft looking for it. Snowflower, he was almost the right target as Gango, with the Whirling Death in the backline, picks up the catfish. And Deft is denied his fifth kill of the game and his 1,000th of the LCK.
All eyes onto Deft. He's not able to pick it up there, but it's still Rascal a bit anemic. Kingan just a bit anemic on the Aatrox, trying to find an inroads to the backline. Rascal isn't scouted out this time, and a big cannon ultimate, I believe, exhausted. You couldn't really tell. Still ripping through health bars. Here's Kingan. He's trying to posture, but it's still score going in alone, right? They just free DPS him down because Kingan isn't there to dive. And from there, you're just waiting for either Deft to hit the mark or Rascal to find in. And Rascal actually gets to come in pretty obviously through a ward. He may get exhausted, but the work is done.
Yeah, exactly right. It was a great exhaust out of Snowflower. That could have been so much worse. In fact, that would probably have been all of them dead in an instant. As Pawn went very aggressively there onto Kingan, but they're not able to take him down. Oh!
He got score, but only into GA.
Yeah, exactly. And he got Kingan, but only into World Ender. Oh, feels bad. Denied so many kills by all of these different stasises.
This feels like Ezreal narrative posturing by the LCK gods. They're saying, you can get everything except your 1,000th kill, Deft.
Yep. Well, I see, you know, 999. I'd still feel pretty good about that one. As damage in the last team fight definitely makes Deft feel wroth.
You guys are wondering, usually personal milestones like this aren't at the forefront of the players' minds. Understandably, they're thinking about the match win, so I'm actually thinking he doesn't know that he's on the precipice of his 1,000th kill.
Yeah, potentially.
But, of course, for us with the full information, the map hacks, it's something endlessly amusing to track. Kingzone continue to just take everything off the map. Gonna watch that replay of Deft saying, will it be score? He actually hit this ult. This was in the picture-in-picture we saw before.
Oh, true shot barrage.
How do you hit
down
that?
To his GA.
He hit
I
it through
know.
Predicting an EQ.
And he also, remember, like, hit him when he was taking his wolves.
Yeah.
When he was taking the ocean drake, when it was blind. He just knows, man. He just knows. That's what happens when you play with score for so long.
And you'd imagine, we don't hear the comms, but I imagine that's not his support saying or his jungler saying, I think he's on wolves. I think that's just Deft intuiting it, right?
Yeah, and again,
processing information and making smart calls. So I like how much of a heads-up play that ult was. Speaking of heads-up play, we're seeing about a 7,000 gold lead here for KT. Gango, he's got three items, so he still does damage. Kingzone could still throw this game. It's just seeming very unlikely.
Yeah, it's not looking exactly like the most throwable game, especially not with all of this vision around this Baron area. You can see Kingzone going for this inner turret on the top side. BDD has teleport. He's going to have to use it if they want to start up a fight here. Don't even know whether it's necessarily an option here for these guys. It's Kingzone. They take down the inner turret. They push this minion wave up, and now, I mean, Baron control is something we don't even really need to talk about because it is in the hands of Kingzone. So far away from KT. Ward in the back of the pit here is actually not spotted until the sweeper does come in.
Very hard to contest this. KT eventually going to have to check
it. How do you get to the pit?
With difficulty, Atlas.
Yeah. Oh, Pawn gets on over. That's a cute little umbral dash to get Kingan out of danger.
KT actually have a bit of a longer leash than most teams because the enemy has no true tank. So it's actually pretty hard for them to peel off Baron. They want to turn earlier rather than later. That's why Kingzone are posturing for a fight. If you told me KT came back and you asked me what did that look like, it would be Kingzone trying to dive under an inhibitor turret and then the relative safety and the defender's advantage that Gango would have in terms of positioning. But actually getting this game to not a Baron state and Kingzone trying to dive is kind of on Kingzone to mess up, right?
So yeah.
We're looking forward. We can say that KT, compared to other teams, if there was a true tank in a vein, you'd be like, we got to get to that pit now. Otherwise, Baron might be dead. No Mountain Drakes, a very squishy lineup. KT get to breathe, get to get their wits around them before they face check, and that might means this game might extend because a lot of the easy objectives for Kingzone are already dead.
Yeah, exactly right. And also, they ran out of control wards. You can see a couple of backs have come in. Cuz and Tucson had to go home, and that's going to give KT this opportunity to clear out the vision. You can see they've already done it all around their red side jungle. And like you say, Respite is now available. See, both of our AD carries very close. Only one CS is going to separate them. As I believe, the money's actually going to be very, very close between Deft and Gango. Just unfortunately, Deft is about to finish off stacking his second tier item, and he's just going to be so incredibly strong.
It's just one of those weird team comps where because it's Draven, if you high roll at the right time and Kingzone as a squishy lineup aren't perfect in their execution, it could still be Subvert. We think heavily that Kingzone would win, but we were focusing on mid-game as the place where it was the least arguable. KT have less items, but they're mostly tank items and the God of Damage behind them. So we're going to have to wait on that Kingzone execution. There's still a lineup that when it comes to execution, we're still evaluating because they're coming together as a five-man roster for the first time this year. They don't have the same runs on the board as some of our other teams. So because of that, we're waiting to see everything fall off. GA back for score. Kingzone ideally just DPS down someone quickly for a pick and make it a 4v5. If everyone's on formation, you watch the Draven and pray as a KT fan.
Yep, precisely. It's looking very dangerous here for KT at this point in time. I do want to point out a bit of a public service announcement.
Listening.
Guys at home, if you see a Draven and you can see right in this game that Ezreal is doing okay, that is not how that goes. Okay, you pick Ezreal into Draven, you're asking for a lot of horrible times. However, this is Deft. He plays Ezreal like no one else.
He also messed up really hard on that aggressive arcane shift and
died. He did. He
so
did.
It was not fraught with danger the entire time, but for certainly some scenarios there. And Gango's farmed out. Again, they would trade a lot for Gango to be at this spot. They don't feel great about it, but Kingzone haven't closed the game just yet. They turn onto Baron again, and we actually don't know if any sweepers are available or any spotting, and they do spot the health bar around 9,000.
Yep. So down to about half health. That is a triple threat on the True Shot Barrage, and Pawn is just waiting to get his claw in there. Gango in trouble. Snowplow already incredibly low. All of the Mystic Shots are landing. As in goes Pawn, he does find the ultimate onto Gango, but he has himself the Mercury's Treads. Okay, Snowflower is going to go down. It's a double kill for Pawn already as Kingen has found the backline. Hero's Entrance comes in as well. It's a decent double taunt, but Cuz gets the next one, and it's on to Gango. That's the bad news story as Kingen going down low. Tucson tries to get him. We're looking for the 1,000th kill. Land it with a Q, Deft. Come on, there it is. 1,000 kills for Deft in the LCK.
Awesome milestone here for one of the gods of AD carry. The ninth player did 1,000 kills in the LCK. Lo Park stands up and applauds. He is already one of our favorite sons. Now he's got another thing behind him. One of the greatest League of Legends AD carries there will ever be.
Yep, and that's, remember, with a lot of time spent over in China as well. So this guy gets a hell of a lot of kills whenever he's here in the LCK.
And he was the EDG win condition for
Absolutely.
Years.
Absolutely. He was the anti-Uzi.
If we add the LPL kills, his regular season kills will be much closer to 1,500, 1,600.
Yep.
But only in Korea after a two-year absence, he comes back. He had to be the hard carry for this lineup, but he's actually got the respite recently. We talked about how he'd be frustrated that Cuz was picking up MVPs last week. He's actually got players around him drawing bans and winning MVPs. And when it comes to the best of five against great teams, you need five strong players. You can't just have one alpaca.
Yep, this is just unfortunately KT too far behind. 8,000 gold was the lead for Kingzone at this point in time. And Cuz just ults right on top of the Draven and there's nothing he can do.
They got a payment plan. Their gold lead over KT was actually reflected in the terms of multiple members diving in, not killing Gango, but stopping Gango from doing any damage in a team fight. So Gango may have taken a long time to die, but his damage in the team fight was so low compared to Deft, who already was going to be a lot more slippery on QSS, Iceborne Gauntlet, Ezreal. He ends the fight with his 1,000th kill, and now they're looking to end the misery of KT Rolston.
Yeah, looking to break open the base. The Baron, of course, did fall down after that battle ensued. Pawn is going to get rid of this inner turret on the bottom side of the map. Uses its claw just to clear out minions. That's when you know Alessandra is very comfortable. You can see this inhibitor turret is not long for the world. The siege minion can't even get up to it here. Can Snowflower and Gango? Finally, the death sentence is going to be exactly that. Onto this siege minion, but now the next one is prepped, and Rascal should be able to see to it. There we go. Infernal Chains do land here, but Kingen probably not wanting to take that fight. Does have a couple of ways to keep himself alive in these team fights, but when he's reviving from the World Ender or the GA, he's not impacting it, and his health bar just goes down so incredibly quickly, as you can already see. Inhibitor goes without KT having any response. Just looks like they have no options here against Kingzone Dragon X. Death Sentence comes in, but Depth is looking for it. These Mystic shots are really hurting. And another inhibitor is sure to follow.
Two and a W, and Snowbower's almost dead. They don't even need to dive in and use Cannon Ultimate. They're getting all the objectives. KT, one last roll of the dice, and I think it's too late.
Yep, Deft is just so incredibly strong right now, able to get these Ws onto these Nexus turrets. Half health for the first one. Teleport to come in as Bond just recharges that health bar. Next one is going to go down. KT need to start a fight soon if they want to keep their Nexus alive, because there's only one turret between them and certain defeat. His score goes in. No GA available just yet. Puts everyone in the baby cage. Triple threat on the True Shot Barrage. And now, KT, you have to go back to your fountain. This one is over. It's time to start looking at game number two, as there's a slicing maelstrom. Some R buttons still need to be pressed, but the Nexus is inevitably going to go down.
And Kingzone continue their clean run, 7-0 in the past seven games. Another unique champion in that run for Rascal. And Deft had to wait a long time for the 1,000th kill, maybe longer than he realized when he was out there on the Rift, stranded on four kills. But around him, another strong performance by the squad. And Kingzone Dragon X don't want to be an afterthought in the top five. They want to be a contender, and they loom as the dark horse for LCK Spring 2019.
And we know the Kingzone as an organization pretty damn good at winning domestically, Papa Smithy. It wasn't until summer 2018 that our KT were finally able to get that one off their back. It's Kingzone that really did dominate, especially 2017, so no strangers to winning games, and they've got the man that put them in their place in the last year.
It was so clear that Kingzone opened up the checkbook big for Deft. He was going to be a player that was so coveted. With Prey leaving the league, with Bang leaving the league, there wasn't a lot of royalty left in the AD carry position. And you look at the other AD carries that were able to pick up a 1,000 kill. Goes all the way back to Prey and Bang. Also, Sangyun is right up there.
Yeah.
And now you have someone like Deft, who after 2 years away, at a time when Sangyun was racking up the kills, that was, of course, the league format where you were most likely to pump your numbers up, and Deft wasn't here. Domestic, he has always been just a powerhouse.
Yeah.
Has Deft, so big result for him. He's going to be smiling in the back, and Kingzone Dragon X, KT tried to roll the dice, but they just weren't able to get their timings going, and I just noticed a lot of lack of synergy on the top side of the map, which compounded an early game that was drafted for and well-engineered by Kingzone.
Yeah, and we'll see whether now KT are going to make some substitutions. I know that they are going to mix things up just a little bit. Whether it's going to be Zenit coming in or whether it's Smeb coming in is going to be the questions, because Gango, he got his Draven, he got his Adoration stacks, and he lost the game. There just was too much control here, and look at that. Deft did 37.3k damage on the Ezreal.
Ezreal does a lot of trade damage, and he was trading in lane. The bold thing is about 4,000 or 5,000 of damage of that was in lane against Draven.
Yeah.
A lot of other AD carries would be cowering in fear. He was Cavalier saying, Tahm Kench has Devour. I'm Arcane shifting in the direction I damn feel like. No wrong directions for him. A one direction forward wins in the game.
Yep, absolutely beautiful stuff there from Deft.